The towering trees, picturesque scenery, and gorgeous coastline of the Pacific Northwest are widely known. However, experts think that what lies between 310,000 feet below the ocean's surface, around 70 miles off that coast, is what we should actually learn about. The region is known as the Cascadia Subduction Zone, a 620-mile-long fault runs from Northern California to British Columbia. It is the spot where the Juan de Fuca plate is gradually encroaching upon and slipping below the North American plate. The pressure is currently building daily. Locking that zone, the pressure will eventually become too great, and the lock will break. Geologists are well aware of this. When it occurs, one plate will push beneath the other, causing one of the biggest earthquakes to ever be recorded, possibly a magnitude 9 or even bigger earthquake. From the coast all the way inland to Boise, Idaho, and even to the southeast into Sacramento in California, the shaking will be felt for hundreds of miles. The ocean water above the section of the seafloor that is sinking will also sink, causing a catastrophic tsunami that would engulf low-lying coastal settlements. Geologists say it is a terrifying possibility that might occur at any time. 319 years ago, in January 1700, a megaquake in the Cascadia Subduction Zone occurred. These massive earthquakes, according to geological evidence, occur around every 250 years, meaning one could occur at any time. The issue is that no one is certain of the exact date. Farts among scientists are improving though. They now estimate that there is a 30% risk that a damaging Cascadia earthquake will occur within the next 50 years. Will communities be prepared? Geologists analyzing the earthquake danger in the area were shocked by simulations of the Cascadia Subduction Zone off the coast of the Pacific Northwest. In addition to another 20 or so earthquakes of magnitude 7 and 8, geological data indicates that the fault has released a magnitude 9 earthquake at least 20 times over the past 10,000 years. A tsunami that engulfed the Pacific Northwest and was felt as far away as Japan was released by the last great Cascadia earthquake, which was probably a magnitude 8 or 9, which rocked the region 317 years ago. The fissure is likely to produce another catastrophic earthquake in the near future. Based on history, according to U.S. seismologist Todd Frankel, there is a 10 to 14% chance of a magnitude 9 earthquake occurring in the next 50 years. The epicenter of an earthquake, the length and direction of the rupture, and the intensity of the tremors along the fault were the three crucial seismic impacts that Frankel and his colleagues modeled in their simulations. They created 50 combinations of these effects. According to study leader Aaron Worth of the University of Washington, the direction in which a rupture develops turned out to be the most harmful aspect. Worth presented her findings at the Geological Society of America's annual meeting in Seattle. If you have a large fault, the earthquake doesn't come from a point. It ruptures over a large area, says Chris Goldfinger, an Oregon State University seismologist who was not a member of the study team but who has unearthed a large amount of evidence for previous earthquakes along the Cascadia Subduction Zone. A rupture often moves at a speed of over 3,600 miles per hour. The Cascadia Subduction Zone would be shaken for 2 to 3 minutes if it were to extend the whole length of it, as it would in the event of a magnitude 9 earthquake. The new simulations demonstrate that an offshore epicenter with an inland moving rupture would harm the region's cities the most. Frankel describes the phenomenon as like a train coming toward you, a sort of Doppler effect where the waves pile up in front of the rupture as the rupture comes toward you. However, if the epicenter is inland, such as in the northwest corner of Washington state, the rupture will spread out to sea and will divert the force of the earthquake away from Seattle. However, no matter where the earthquake begins under the continent or off the coast, northwest won't escape unharmed. Frankel asserts that shaking will result in serious consequences in each of these cases, as many homes and structures in Seattle and other northwest towns were built before local building laws included any seismic precautions. Those shocks will pose a significant threat to their residents. According to Goldfinger, Even very slight shaking will cause a great deal of damage to cities with delicate infrastructure. Engineers will use Frankel and his team's data to determine whether or not existing buildings can withstand the force of a magnitude 9 earthquake. Engineers have already begun receiving their data from Frankel and his team. Without a doubt, the area will experience a megaquake at some point, Goldfinger declares. There is no doubt at all. There is no disputing the persuasiveness of the geological findings we anticipated to arrive. And now let's take a look back at the M9 Cascadia megathrust earthquake along the western coast of North America. At 9 p.m. on January 26, 1700, one of the biggest earthquakes ever recorded struck. During a massive earthquake, the undersea Cascadia thrust fault broke along a 1,000 kilometers stretch from the middle of Vancouver Island to Northern California, causing intense shaking and a massive wave that rushed across the Pacific. The smaller offshore Juan de Fuca plate, which is sliding under the much bigger North American plate, is separated by the Cascadia fault on Vancouver Island. The quake's shaking triggered numerous landslides and the collapse of houses belonging to the Cowichan people. People were unable to stand due to the shaking's intensity, and it lasted for so long that it frightened them. The Pakenabe people's winter settlement on Vancouver Island's west coast was entirely devastated by the tsunami, leaving no survivors. The oral histories of the First Nations people of Vancouver Island contain descriptions of these incidents. Along the Japanese Pacific coast, the tsunami that surged across the Pacific also left devastation. We can reliably determine the size and precise time of this powerful earthquake thanks to the Japanese people's reliable descriptions of the tsunami and precise timekeeping. As the outer coastal region sank and drowned coastal marshlands and woodlands, the earthquake also left distinct traces in the geological record that were later hidden by more recent deposits. According to the geological record, there are clear indications that the event that occurred on January 26, 1700, was not a one-time occurrence but rather has occurred numerous times at sporadic intervals over the course of many centuries. There have been 13 large earthquakes in the previous 6,000 years. According to geological data, researchers now know that a future offshore event resembling this one will occur, and that it will pose a significant risk to residents of southwest British Columbia. Despite this, because the fault is offshore, major west coast cities are not particularly at risk from earthquakes. The tectonic plates become firmly attached to one another between large earthquakes, although they still move in the same direction. The crust of the Earth is subjected to extreme strain and distortion in the coastal region, which results in ongoing earthquake activity. We currently find ourselves in this circumstance. There have been 4 earthquakes with a magnitude of 7 or higher in southwest British Columbia and northern Washington state within the previous 130 years, demonstrating the size of certain onshore quakes. The biggest earthquake risk comes from these inland earthquakes because they can happen more frequently and are often considerably closer to our urban centers. Over $200 billion worth of damage was done in 1995 by an inland magnitude 6.9 earthquake that occurred beneath Kobe, Japan in a similar geological environment. And so, are we prepared? California can lessen the effects of earthquakes by making new construction and upgrading older ones in accordance with building codes, as well as through increasing public knowledge and readiness. Public policy and effective action at the governmental, community, and private levels must be driven by awareness. However, do you think this is enough? Let us know what you think in the comments section below. And please subscribe to Weather Collapse if you want to know more and be updated on the latest news about natural calamities or disasters happening all over the world. And don't forget to like today's video. We'll see you in the next video. Thanks for watching.